Welcome once again to TREX. I think this will be the second video. I'm starting the wrong way, you know. Welcome to TREV Ministries, where truth is revealed, explained, and visualized. This is TREX, where you send it, I react to it, we enjoy it, we learn from it. That's the purpose of this series. I hope that you learn something new. I hope that you will be a part of this discussion as well. So we'll get right into it. We will continue looking at some videos that you've sent already. Again, I want to encourage you to go to the channel, TREV Ministries, and subscribe. Be a part of the community so that you can share your videos as well. These are some of the links that have been sent. Now, it looks like I sent it to myself, right? But the thing is, most of the individuals that subscribe to me, they are my friends, right? So they would send it directly to me on WhatsApp whenever they come across it. So I just send the links here so it's easier for me to see it. It's easier for me to have the list organized, right? So I send it as soon as I get it, and that's the list that I have so far. Feel free to send your videos that you would like me to react to as well, all right? So that's the goal. I hope to get a lot more videos in the coming future. So as you can see, I have two tabs open. There are two Facebook Reels that I would like to reply to, respond to. So that is what I'm going to do right now. Let's get right into it. I'm going to start with this one. All right, so. I like it. I think that's a powerful video right there. And it's a personal video. It's something I believe we can all relate to. I really think we can all relate to that. And I mean, this can turn into a Bible study right now. There are so many points that are coming up in the video. The waiting on you is a powerful one, because to wait on God doesn't mean that you are idly doing nothing. To wait on God means that you are expecting, you're depending on Him as you work. That's really what it means to wait on God. You know, you'd realize in some instances, there are stories where God says, you know what, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, right? So exactly, just do absolutely nothing, but believe in me, I will take care of it. There are a lot of stories like that. But there are other instances where He wants us to wait on Him, not by doing nothing, but to work in harmony with Him. And there are a couple stories like that as well, where He gives instructions, but then He does the rest, right? He is asking us to do what we can do so that He will do what we cannot do. So it really depends on the situation that you're in. Another thing that stood out to me in this video is that there are some instances where we pray and we get impatient because God does not answer the prayer in time. There are so many ways we can look at this. Number one, it is possible that the prayer that you prayed is not according to God's will. We just need to accept that sometimes, you know. Again, and the Bible actually does say that. There are some instances, let's look at, for example, James chapter 4. And we're going to look at this one here. James chapter 4 verse 3, it says, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss or incorrectly, you ask wrongly, you ask for the wrong things, that you may consume it upon your lusts. Yes, it is true that God may not answer the prayer because He believes that it will simply destroy your character, that it would be worse for you if that prayer was answered the way that you wanted the prayer to be answered. So that might be why a prayer is not being answered. The next thing I want us to look at is that sometimes God is teaching us to depend on Him. He is teaching us to wait on Him. Why is it that we trust the wisdom of God in giving us the right things, but we don't trust the wisdom of God in giving it to us at the right time? We need to trust the timing of God as well. So if He chooses to answer the prayer in 13 years, as He did with Abraham, then that we should remain faithful to God until that time gets there. The point is, I'm sure you've seen it before, that if a door is closed, praise God in the hallway. And I think that's a powerful principle, that we should remain faithful to God. We should trust God, wait on God, even if the door is closed. That's another point I think is important. The last one I want to look at, because I want this video to be as short as possible. The last point that comes to mind is discernment. There are instances in your life where God has already answered the prayer, but because the answer did not come in the way that you wanted it to come, that you think that God did not answer the prayer. That's the thing. Sometimes we expect some kind of good news as the answer to prayer, but maybe it's bad news. Maybe the door being closed is the answer to your prayer. So in addition to praying to God for something that you want, it's important that you pray to God and ask Him for the discernment so that you can see how His hand moves in your life. I think it's important that you understand that there are principles that come with prayer. There are principles that come with the character of God that we need to be able to understand as we navigate our relationship with Him. You know, so that's what really stood out to me. I love that video. I think it's something that we should all remember, that God is in control, that God is taking care of us, that God is working all things together for our good. If we love God and we are called to His purpose, we can have that assurance. What God is calling us to do is to be faithful to Him and to remain obedient to Him and to open our eyes that we may see when the prayer is answered, if the prayer is answered, or how He chooses to answer the prayer. All right, so lovely video.
2 times 2. They both look alike when you start. See, this is what the devil does. 2 plus 2 is 4. 2 times 2 is 4. And what he wants you to believe is, why should I give? Why should I live right? Why should I love God if I'm gonna get the same results the people who don't do it get it? What you don't realize is God did not call you for addition. He called you to multiplication. Which means if you stay the course on this level, it looked the same. But what's 2 plus 3? 5. What's 2 times 3? 6. Because when God starts multiplying, you start skipping levels. And I don't know who I'm preaching to. I done spent too many years of my life trying to make stuff add up. This my season to make stuff multiply. How is it going to multiply? Good measure. Press down. Woo. Shaking together. It's the principle of multiplication. God did not call you just to maintain. He called you to multiply. I need your help. What's 2 plus 2?
Let me. All right. So there's something that came to mind. And it's true that some of us, maybe all of us, have asked that question before. Why do the wicked prosper? Why is it that I do everything right and I could just never get that breakthrough in my life? I could just never prosper the way I want to. And there are so many wicked people that do blatantly, openly wicked things, and yet they seem to prosper. Now, believe it or not, this is a question that comes up in the Bible more often than you think. I believe David asked that question. Habakkuk asked that question. I think Jeremiah asked that question as well. And the answers are different. They are quite different when the question is asked, why do the wicked prosper? When I think of God's answer to David, I think it says, when I entered the sanctuary, then I understood their end. And the point is that the prosperity on this earth is not something to envy. Because remember, as Christians, as Seventh-day Adventists, we are just passing through. We are preparing for a heaven. We should never forget that. So why is it that we complain about the prosperity of the wicked only when it's material gain? That's another problem by itself. Why is it that we only consider prosperity something that's material? Is not salvation more valuable than material possession? I consider myself, we should consider ourselves to be more prosperous than anybody else, because prosperity is not based on material gain. Prosperity is based on Christ. You understand? Because it is according to His riches in glory that we are blessed. It is according to His riches in glory that we are saved. So that is really where the riches take place. That, you know, even the Bible encourages us to buy of Christ gold tried in the fire. And of course, that represents faith and love. You know, you think of 1 Peter 1:7. You think of James chapter 2 verse 5. You know, Galatians chapter 6 verse 5 as well. That's the point. That's what true richness is. So I think we need to change our perspective on what prosperity is. And as a result of that, we will not be envious of the apparent prosperity of the wicked. Oh, another point too, we don't know how they got the money. We don't know how they got the cars and the clothes and the fame and all of that. We don't know how. So again, and I'm sure there's a proverb for that. I am sure there's a proverb for that. But we should not envy them because we don't know how they got it. I am sure that if we were to know, there are some things that they would have done that we would never do because it's against the word of God. So again, there's no reason, there really is no reason to be envious of the material prosperity of the wicked. That's one thing that stood out to me. Now, there's a text, there's a text that he used, good measure, let me see, if pressed down, shaken together, right. I find it quite convenient, and I'm not fighting the preacher. I'm not fighting him at all. But I find it quite convenient that the most important point of the text was not mentioned at all. When the scripture refers to good measure being pressed down and shaken together and running over, notice that in order for that to take place, the natural result, the natural prerequisite for that to take place is to give. This text really and truly actually refers to the benefits of giving. Not the benefit of asking, not the providence of God to prosper us as Christians. That's not the point. The point is that as we give, we receive. As we give from the fountain of God, we receive more from the fountain of God. It is only that way we can truly prosper. That's the whole point of being a giving Christian. Because as we give from what God has blessed us with, it is God that continues to bless us. Even if, the text is clear. It says that men will be the ones giving into your bosom. I'm not taking that away. I'm saying that God is the one setting up these men to bless us as we bless others. So the principle of that passage is to give. The principle of that passage is not to ask. The principle of that passage is not to expect. The principle of that passage is not to give expecting. That's not the principle of the passage. The principle of the passage is to give. We give as God has blessed us, and as a result of that, He will bless us continually, because that's the whole point of stewardship too. That if you are faithful in that which is little, then we'll become faithful in much. You know that the Bible is very clear on that. So if God has blessed me with, you know, a very, very small salary, and I am able to return tithe, I am able to give offering, I'm able to feed the poor and help where I can with that small salary, then it means that I would have developed the character that God would have developed that character in me. And as a result of that, He realizes He can trust me with more. Yes, it is true that God may not prosper many of us because He cannot trust us with more. So I believe the Bible is very clear that the highest priority of Christianity is love for others. With what we have, we should be loving others. And whether God chooses to prosper us more or not, whether God chooses to give us more material possessions or not, the goal is to give. And I think that's the main point. So I don't agree with the use of the text. I think that, the entire context should be given. Of course, it is true that you can apply a text in another context as long as it does not violate the rest of Scripture. I have a video on that as well. It's a keys for study. It's when it's out of context. When out of context is appropriate. I believe I have a video on that as well. Thank you guys so much for the videos that you send. Again, I want to encourage you to send more of the videos that you want me to react to in the community tab. Again, it's quite easy to find as well. And the more videos you send, the better it is. I will react to them as soon as I can. Thank you so much for sending what you have. Thank you so much for the comment in advance. Thank you so much for the participation. Until the next video, TREV Ministries, over and out.